So it took a genius Euler to figure out this is pi squared over 6. We can't figure that out at the moment. Could we figure out it converges, though? Yes, we can. Through a bit of ingenuity. Let's let f of x be 1 over x squared. What I'm going to do is I'm going to relate the infinite series and whether it converges or not to the convergence of the improper integral of this from 1 to infinity. Chapter 7, we know the improper integral of f of x. Well, again, by definition is a limit of proper integrals like this. And we did this calculation before. We get the limit as b goes to infinity. The integral will be negative x to the negative 1 evaluated from 1 to b. That'll be, in the end, the limit as b goes to infinity of, it'll be 1 minus 1 over b. And that equals 1. It exists. The improper integral converges to 1. We knew that. The p here is 2, and 2 is bigger than 1. We talked about that. We can relate this to the series in a graphical way. If I graph this function, 1 over x squared, f of x equals 1 over x squared, I can treat the terms of the series as areas of rectangles under this curve. Well, except for the first term. I mean, I could add that as well into the picture, but I'm not going to. We know at x equals 1, this function is 1 over 1 squared, which is 1. At x equals 2, the value of the function is 1 over 2 squared, which is 1/4. At x equals 3, the value is 1 over 3 squared, which is 1/9. At x equals 4, the value of the function is 1/16. At 5, it's 1/25, etc. We know the improper integral converges, meaning the area under this curve from 1 to infinity exists. It's finite and in fact equals 1, even though the region goes on to the right forever and ever, because that's how you define what the area is as a limit, and this limit does exist. Our series has nth partial sum, 1 plus a 4th plus a 9th plus a 16th plus a 25th, etc., up through 1 over n squared. That's a finite sum. If I draw in the following rectangles, this one here, this one here, they're getting very short here now, this one here, etc., those rectangles all have a base of 1 and a height equal to the numbers 1/4, 1/9, 1/16, etc. They're under the graph of f, so the sum of those areas is less than the area under the graph of f. This is less than or equal to 1 plus the integral from 1 to n of 1 over x squared. And that integral we just found was 1 minus 1 over b, but now I'll write it as 1 minus 1 over n. Sn is less than or equal to 2 minus 1 over n. This one that is in front, by the way, is just going right there. What's in parentheses is bounded by the integral. So what does this mean? Listen very carefully. For each value of n, Sn, the nth partial sum of this Basel problem, sum of reciprocals of perfect squares, is always less than or equal to 2 minus 1 over n, which itself is always less than or equal to 2 for all positive integers n. So Sn is always less than or equal to 2. these Sn's keep getting bigger as n gets bigger because I keep adding more and more terms. They keep getting bigger. They move to the right on a number line, but they never get past 2. They have to converge to something less than 2. And pi squared over 6 was about 1.6 something, is less than 2. That's technically a theorem that I'm using in section 9.1. S1 is here. S1 is, well, 1. S2 is 1 plus 1 fourth, 5 fourths, 1.25. S3 is here. S4 is here. They keep moving to the right, getting bigger and bigger, but they for sure never get past 2. They have to gang up, so to speak, on some number here, less than 2. And that number does happen to be pi squared over 6. But you'd never know that just looking at this, what I did here. But you do know this converges because of it always being less than or equal to 2. Technically, what I'm using is something called the completeness of the real numbers there. I'm not going into details. Should make some intuitive sense. You keep moving to the right, but you never get past some point. You've got to get arbitrarily close to something. Another way to prove this converges is to use something called the integral test. Effectively, the argument that I just gave, thinking about areas, can be generalized to a situation where you use this integral test. Here's the integral test. Suppose an equals f of n, or if you prefer, ak equals f of k, the letter doesn't matter. And suppose f of x is a decreasing and positive function, like our function 1 over x squared is. It's decreasing and positive. I graphed it. When x is greater than or equal to 1 is the assumption here. If the integral, the improper integral of f from 1 to infinity converges, like our example does, then the infinite series converges as well. Textbook is not writing n goes from 1 to infinity here. That's understood. Kind of like with Riemann sums, the book's being a bit sloppy here. It's understood this is an infinite series, an infinite sum, n going from 1 to infinity. Again, we could use k instead of n. It doesn't matter. The series converges. On the other hand, if the improper integral diverges, then the series diverges. This is called the integral test. So what you need to do when you apply this is you need to take your series, the sum of the a's, ak or an, figure out a function f of x so that this is true, and so f is positive and decreasing when x is greater than or equal to 1. Decide if the improper integral converges or not, and conclude about the series. One very important case for this is for P series. This is the analog of the corresponding fact for improper integrals. We knew the improper integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over x to the p converged when p was bigger than 1 and diverged when p is less than or equal to 1. Remember the case where p equals 1, the antiderivative was a logarithm, and logarithms do go to infinity as the input goes to infinity. Therefore, by that integral test on the previous page, this series called the P series converges if P is bigger than 1 and diverges if P is less than or equal to 1. It does converge when P is 2 to pi squared over 6. It converges to when P is 3 to zeta of 3, whatever that is. It can be approximated. When P is 4, it converges to something involving pi to the 4th. When P is any positive even number, it converges to something involving pi to that power. Some simple fraction times pi. I mean, the fraction itself could be involve humongous numbers, as it did when p was 20, but it's still relatively simple as an idea.